Hello again after the lunch break. Hope you've got your share, but don't worry, the food will be served throughout the day, so if you'd like to fill up once again, it will be upstairs. So vegan and vegetarian options are also available now, so yeah, make sure to eat, stay hydrated, and all that good stuff. Yeah, please also use your Heapcon passports. Get them stamped so you will be in a raffle for valuable prize by the end of the conference. Okay, so I will introduce our next speaker, Mihailo Joksimovic. He's a senior software engineer from Microsoft. Take the floor. Good luck.
Thank you. Entry-level positions are actually the best, you know. You start as a fresh grad, or as an intern, or you do a career change, if you will. But one way or another, if you just, you know, follow the rules, meet the deadlines, do an okay-ish job, eventually you will reach the mid-year level and sometime after the senior level, right? So the path from junior to senior is pretty much linear wherever you start from, right? The problem is, once you do reach the senior level, things become anything but linear, right? It becomes dark, murky, scary. What now? You know, like, did they dead end my career, or where do I go? So there are so many options, right? So that's exactly what this presentation is going to be about. What your options are once you do reach the senior level, right? Now, before I start giving advice, I'd like to share some credentials first, right? And I want to do so because you really should know who you're taking the advice from, all right? So you should know who I am and basically where do I come from. So I'm Mihailo. I work as a senior engineer at Microsoft. I work in the Azure SQL, like the SQL Server in cloud version, or as people like to say, I build databases. But that hasn't always been the case, all right? Like, I joined Microsoft a year and a bit ago, so I had some other experiences, and I'll be sharing them alongside the Microsoft one. Right? So if you were to open my LinkedIn page, for example, what you would see is that I had more or less, give or take, 15 years of experience. All right? And if you scroll down through my LinkedIn profile, you'd see some lesser known companies there, all right? Like remote first, lesser known, maybe more known in USA or whatnot, but definitely not very well known, right? After that, you might see that at one point, I worked at chess.com, which is basically one of the more popular names on my resume, up until Microsoft, obviously. And to tell you the truth, one of my biggest career regrets is that I left chess.com too early, back in 2012. I wanted to pursue something else, like I wanted to do the office job and whatnot, so I left, and as I said, it's one of my career regrets that I have. We'll talk about that. I worked in some more familiar companies, at least more known in Serbia, like Jagger and stuff like that. You know, the companies that some people might have heard of. All right, so I worked there, and I explored some options there as well. At one point, I felt crazy enough. I also built a startup. Basically, I don't recommend that, so don't do that at home. We'll talk about that as well. If you're feeling masochistic enough, you can definitely do that as well. And obviously, eventually, I joined Microsoft rather recently, and I definitely recommend it. So if you're thinking about doing it, definitely do it. It's so far, it's one of the best gigs I had in every possible aspect. But again, we'll get to that in big tech. Now, as I said in the beginning, when you're just starting, all right, like when you're at the beginning of your career, everything is, you know, shiny, bright, it's the direction is clear, you know, as long as you meet the deadlines and do the okay work and basically show some initiative, whatnot, you will progress, right? The only question is, like, how fast do you progress? Like, if you invest yourself really too much into it, you'll probably reach the mid-year level sooner. But, you know, like, and senior eventually, and if you're a bit of a slower and more like work-life balance kind of person, you might take a bit more time, but eventually you get to mid-year and you reach the senior, right? So the path is quite clear. The only problem that I have to emphasize is that it's like a regular path to senior, right? One thing that I've observed, and I can imagine some of you observing as well, is that there is alternative path to reaching senior level at the company you're in. And that's basically people who just stick long enough around, right? You have people in companies who, you know, they never become even mid-years or let alone seniors, but they just stay long enough around, they learn the product, they meet the people, they meet the managers, they even start talking to customers, whatnot. So basically they develop some other skills and they eventually reach the senior level in the company. Now that's great for that company, right? Like being senior there, but it's really hard, and I like to say it's almost a dead end, career dead end, if you're trying to switch the job. Because you never really developed the skills that actually make you senior, but you became senior and you know the pay goes with it and nobody wants to go to middle position like 10 years into their career and whatnot. So that could be a dead end. Now, I'm not saying that anybody here is at that position, because just by the fact that you're attending a conference and that you're attending a career talk, and this exactly is a career talk, that definitely means that you're not that kind of person, all right? You're a person who wants to invest into themselves and their career, but obviously we have to discuss all the possible paths that lead to senior. So as I said, I skipped the slide. Anyway, basically, once you do reach the senior level, the things become a bit dark, right? It's like unclear where to go, what to do, and you know, like what are your career options. So basically, as I said on the slide that I mistakenly skipped while I was talking about it, basically throughout my career, I worked both as an IC and as like individual contributor. Basically, I was a software engineer. And I also worked as a manager, so and I definitely, I'm definitely more into the IC work. But from this experience, I will be telling you, like, I will be discussing your potential career options, right? So what are the options that at least I can discuss, right, that I tried and that I know some do's and don'ts about that you could do once you reach the senior level, right? So I see a couple of them, right? So the first option, the most obvious one, is pretty much stay at the same company for like ever, right? And there is a lot of stigma, honestly speaking, tied to this. And to tell you the truth, I don't know why. I think the problem is that people just think that you're not good enough if you're sticking for long enough in the same company. And there is also a problem that many companies don't really have career paths after the after the senior level, right? So there are some bigger tech companies that after the senior level have a principal, partner, architect, solution architect, whatnot. That's more of a rarity than it's like a commonality, so to speak, right? So most of the people actually work in companies that once they reach the senior level, there's not much to progress. And basically the question is like why are you sticking so long at the same company? And I actually had this question asked. I stayed at the previous company for 6 years. And I had a couple of people ask me like why have you been there so long? And I'm like, what? You know? And then on the other hand, if you go, for example, to Microsoft or any other big tech, you can see people like staying there for like 20, 30, 40 years, right? So what's the catch? Well, the catch is that like bigger companies who actually have need for like higher positions, they actually have the initiative to keep you long enough, and they have positions to like keep you in the climbing the career ladder as an individual contributor. For example, in Microsoft, you start when you're a junior, or software engineer, you start at level 59, and beats me why it started at 59. I absolutely tried understanding. Like intern is level 58. Junior is 59, I have no idea why. But the point is, like, you start at level 59, at level 63, you reach the senior level, and there are individual contributor levels up to level 80, which is a technical fellow, and mind you, there are only like 20 technical fellows in the whole world. So it takes some time, especially after you reach the senior level, it takes some time to climb the career ladder, but the point is, you have options, right? So you could stick around for long enough, you're pay will follow, the promotions will follow, you basically go from senior to principal, from principal to partner, from partner to distinguished, and from distinguished engineer to technical fellow, right? Now, when it comes to smaller companies, so to say, there is a lot of stigma, as I said, tied to, just like PHP has a lot of stigma, right? If anybody's doing PHP, they're probably a bad engineer. I used to work PHP a lot. I used to do a lot of PHP, you know, and I'd say that I went out fine, so I survived, you know. And to tell you the truth, we'll discuss this in more details, definitely, but I have some examples of some people who definitely profited a lot by staying in the same company, by sticking around in the same company, right? Another option that your company definitely will want you to take is to go to management, right? I did that eventually. I can't really make up my mind whether I liked it or not. It was a funny stint, so to speak. And we'll discuss that as well, like what are some do's and don'ts, pros and cons. But this is something that usually most people like progress towards, you know, like they call it promotion. I think that's a really shitty way of saying stuff. So the promotion, it's a change of tracks. You have an option of moving to big tech, right? Because basically, like you can always go to big tech and stay senior engineer or like, because in big tech, usually if you reach the senior level, you can stay there throughout your whole life. Nobody will care, you know, like if you don't want more responsibility, perfect, just stay a senior and care about your stuff and that's it, right? You can move to big tech. I'll discuss that as well, because I, for example, moved to big tech like after, I don't know, 14 years of experience, and it was a funny, how to say, experience trying to move there for years. As I said, you can build a startup if you're crazy enough. I hope you're not, because that's like the stupidest thing that you can probably do. Definitely, if you want to do it, great, we'll talk about it. I really think it's one of the craziest things, unless you're feeling like enthusiastic and masochistic, right? And that's about it that I'm familiar with, right? So there are some options that I'm personally not familiar with. Like I know people that go to work for startups. That's a viable option, and that can be a great option as well. Yeah, I know people who move to consulting as well. You know, that's also a viable option, but I can't talk much about those because I don't have such experience, right? So what I'm saying here is only the stuff that I have personal experience with, all right? And that's the stuff that I can answer questions about, right? So let's discuss each of these options and pros and cons. And basically, if you have additional questions, please feel free to enter them into this Vault lookalike app, Vova or whatever. So enter your questions, and I'll be happy to cover them either here or like after the presentation. Right. So the first option, as I said, is staying at the same place forever. As I said, honestly speaking, I would say that for most people, especially as you go into your 30s and 40s, this could be honestly the best option, especially if you're feeling that the company is it, right? And if you're saying, well, basically, I won't progress, my finances won't match, yada, yada, yada. Yeah, there are some downsides, but there are a lot of pros. And I'll tell you some pros that I've seen. I mentioned chess.com, that I worked there like 11 years ago. I had some friends who joined chess literally like months after I left or before I left in that same period. And I have one of my best friends who's all of them are actually sticking around, but I have one of the best friends who I meet at least once per month. He has been there since, I can't really remember if he joined before I left or after I left, but he's been there for like 10 plus years, all right? And to tell you the truth, for one, he profited in terms of finances like massively, like seriously massively. The second thing is he knows CEO, he knows the whole company. Basically, he can take a day off, time off. He can take anything that he wants. So his work-life balance is great. So he has finances in check. He has work-life balance in check. He's actually getting to work on some really cool shit, to be honest, like due to lack of a better word. Like he really gets some great projects. And mind you, chess.com exploded during the COVID and that TV show like Queen's Gambit. So he really got to work on some massively great scaling problems, you know, like, and that's something that you have to earn. Nobody's going to give you that once you move to the company. Only if you move to a startup that's in the exploding phase, right? Basically, so, and overall, he's just happy there, all right? I also know a lot of examples from my previous company, Jagger. Like for example, my ex-boss, who I also named my son after, to be honest, because he was also my mentor and pretty much influenced my life a lot. He retired early. Like he retired in his, I don't know, early 40s or something. He started working at that company. It wasn't Jagger at the time. He started at that company when he was, I don't know, 20 something, stuck there for like 15, 20 years, whatever it is. I don't know. last 10 years, I can guarantee that he didn't work that much. Like, he was working maybe a couple of hours per day. He was getting massive finances. He had a great work-life balance, you know. And basically, he just retired early because he spent all other time investing into, I don't know, whatever he was investing in, all right. So, and I also know more people, like, he wasn't my manager, but I know a lot of people from that company who retired early, right? So staying in the same company can really be beneficial if you play your cards right. Like, there are some downsides, of course, and downsides are if it's a shitty company, for one. Like if you're in a bad place, you definitely should run away, all right? It can destroy yourself, your career, your self-esteem, pretty much. Like, it can ruin you. But if you're feeling okay, like, you don't have to feel perfect. If you're feeling okay, definitely think about staying there. Another problem is the longer you stick at the same company, the less they know what to do with you, right? Because, I mean, like, and then they start making up positions like solution architects, software architects, whatever, which is the great position at that company, right? But if you're trying to mimic that to other companies, and if you're trying to change a job, good luck with that, all right? So I was a solution architect at one point, and nobody could understand what I was doing, right? So it made a lot of sense for me and my company at the time, but nobody had any clue, like, what that was, right? So I was engineering as far as they are concerned. So changing the job can be a problem, like if you want to change the job, and usually the finances aren't the best, it's just the way it works, right? Like, sometimes it works out, but sometimes the finance, you could probably earn more if you move to another company, right? So those are some pros and cons. I still do recommend it as one of the best options that you probably can do if you're feeling good about your place, right? Next thing, the infamous moving to management, right? Now, there are a lot of differing opinions on this topic. On one hand, the company usually wants you to move towards management because they want you to apply your knowledge and everything you do. They want you to apply it on a bigger scale, on you know, like to influence people, to influence the product, to lead. But there's also a thing called Peter's principle, which says that people usually get promoted to the level of their incapability, you know. So people get promoted like until they are incapable of doing their current position and they dead end career eventually, you know. So in terms of management, I've seen, and I'm pretty sure that at least some of you or all of you have witnessed people who they move to management, and obviously the biggest danger when moving to management is that, like, you reach the senior level and then they give you like a senior manager title or something like that. It's like you're getting promotion, right? That's such a danger that destroys so many people, honestly speaking. And I can imagine some of you felt it on their own skin, or some of you saw it, all right? Management is a great career path, but it's a completely different profession, all right? And if you go from being a senior at whatever your place right now is, if you go from being a senior to being a senior engineer to being a senior manager, and if you think that the same things will apply, you're screwed, all right? And that's exactly what happens, you know, like people go from being a senior engineer, the person of interest, the point of everything, you know, like the man or the woman, they go to being a manager and they collapse, all right? Because management requires completely different set of skills, and some of them are related to engineering, definitely, but most of them aren't, all right? The game changes a lot. Like, now you have to deal with people more than with the code, and I mean, it's great when everything works out, but you really have to do some shitty conversations, some tough conversations. You have to put people on performance improvements. You have to tell people that that's not the way you behave in front of the people. But, like, I had so many crazy talks that literally make my skin get goosebumps, you know? Like, it's really tough, honestly speaking. So if you're considering going into management, and let me not scare you, I mean, management can really be rewarding, both in terms of finances and career and basically the influence. If you're kind of the person who wants to work on a bigger scale through people, my advice is to actually go and inform yourself before you move to management. And at the end of this presentation, I'll have some books there are only a few books about engineering management. A lot of books are about like manufacturing and whatnot, management in those things. So I'll recommend some books, and even if you're not considering going into management, I would advise you to go through them just to understand like how it is to be a manager. And one thing that being a manager means, it's like you have to use a meeting as a tool that for doing your job, all right? And that can be like crazy enough if you are an engineer, right? So I luckily, or coincidentally, or whatever, I read about what it means to become an engineer, and I actually start, like, I really wanted to try that path. And as it turned out, my boss was also planning to retire himself early. So basically, I took over his position, and as I said, I have a mixed feelings about how I felt. On one hand, it was great, you know, like you get to work on so many things, you get to see so many things, you get to see the product, not the code, right? When you're just writing the code, you're all about the code. But once you move a step outward, you know, like it's you see the product and like some other things, right? So it can be rewarding. It can also destroy you, like if you're not prepared for a career change. And as I said, so many companies make it a promotion. And just by thinking that you are promoted, it brings a lot of stigma. One of those things is that you don't want to be downmoted to IC, right? Like nobody wants to go to management and then downgrade or whatever themselves to being an IC, right? So I'll recommend some resources on that, and we can discuss that as well. I personally chose to eventually quit that. And one thing that I miss from the management days is that like there were so many things going on in the same day. Like I would work on 50 things in the same day, like multitask like crazy, like do this, do that. There was always something burning, whatnot. When I moved to Microsoft to be an IC, it was like super slow, and people started criticizing me because I was trying to do more than one thing at a time, and I was like, what the hell is going on, you know? So it's an interesting ride, so to speak, and I definitely do recommend it, but do get some info upfront about what it means, and I'll share some useful resources about that. Third one, obviously, you can always move to big tech, and I would like to definitely invite you to join Microsoft or whatever. Like, there are a lot of big tech or bigger tech. There are a lot of great companies in Serbia that are considered big tech or on the same level. One downside of joining is that the preparation path, especially from senior level, can really suck, honestly speaking. Unless you're like a famous person or somebody knows you, preparing for big tech and preparing for interviews is absolute pain in the ass, all right? Like, you have to go through the exact same interview that you would be doing if you're just starting your career, like data structures, algorithm, crack the coding interview, whatnot. And let me tell you, after 15 years of experience, you feel that like an absolute idiot not being able to solve like a simple problem on lead code or whatnot, you know? So I was, for example, preparing for Microsoft for 3 years, more or less. And I also, that's also the number of times I tried applying for Microsoft. Eventually it worked out, obviously, but during the preparation, it was absolute nightmare, and I thought about giving up like so many times. Honestly speaking, I just felt plain stupid. Like, is it possible that like I can't solve a single simple lead code problem? Like, I don't know, sort array or whatnot, right? It gets better. Like, everything gets better with practice. To tell you the truth, it was absolutely worth it. The pay is great. The people are amazing. You get to work with some really smart people, and that's really a boost to your career and to your ego. The projects that you can work on are just, you know, like unmatched by, right? Some people would complain that, for example, I work on SQL Server in the cloud, but also on the SQL Server engine itself. It's basically the SQL Server is like, I don't know, 40 years old code base or whatever that went through two rewrites, I think, that I'm familiar with. But some people call it legacy. I think that doing that kind of archaeological work that some of you call legacy is absolutely amazing, because you actually get to see the code that's in production and serving some incredibly huge companies. Like, I don't know, in our case, it's like American Airlines or whatever, right? So you get to work on some really huge challenges, engineering challenges, and you get some massive exposure to some things like deployment pipelines, the telemetry, you know, the stuff that I didn't even dream of, you know. So it can be really rewarding, but it sucks to get in, right? I don't know too many downsides, because, you know, I've been there for only a bit of my career, but I'll make sure to let you know what the downsides are like once I find them, right? And finally, if you're crazy enough, as I said, you can go about building a startup. Mind you, I'm not saying joining the startup, because that's completely a different story. Like, joining a startup can be great in every possible term, right? Building a startup It's pretty much everything that you probably think it is, it's exact opposite, right? And what most people think it is, it's basically the bullshit that's being solved on LinkedIn, Twitter, I don't know, whatever platforms, like that life coaches and other idiots try to sell you, right? Work for yourself, work whenever you want, be at the, my favorite, be at the source of the money, and I'm intentionally using the middle finger for that, like be at the source of the income, whatnot, like, that's such a bullshit, honestly, like, we had a startup which was, I don't know, at one point, I was a co-founder and I had 500 people working with me who co-founded this startup. It was the most stressful period in my life by every possible sense. Yes, you do. You are at the source of income, but it's great when there is no income, you know? Like, so there were so many months when I was just literally thinking, like why the hell am I doing this? I mean, like, I'm working day and night, and mind you, like, forget about work-life balance. You're always working, and they try to sell you, like, well, there are no managers. Every client, every customer is a manager of yours, and basically, trust me, like, when you have a manager in an actual company, you can go to HR and complain and change a manager. When a customer is your manager, like, they can just move away if they're dissatisfied with your service, and you're at the source of empty income, right? So, honestly speaking, I found it to be incredibly stressful, incredibly painful. Like, it was rewarding in some areas, like you get to work, I don't know, you get to work the sales, to work the tech, to work the support, to work the DevOps. You pretty much get to work the whole cycle of things, and you get exposed to seeing how product is built and how product is failing, but that's another story. But the point is, like, you definitely do get some rewarding experiences, but overall, I think it's like you should only do it if you really have something burning inside of you, like you really have an idea that you want to see develop. And this is really my personal opinion. My advice is to try it either if you're like in your 20s, no family, whatever, like super enthusiastic, can work day and night, can work weekends, because like forget about the weekends, all right? Like, it's not like you can complain to HR if the customer is calling you on the weekend, right? Either if you are in your 20s and you don't have anything better to do with your life, or if you're like, I don't know, late 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, whatever, when you have your network developed and you actually have something tangible that you know will work out and whatever. Again, really my personal opinion, but I definitely don't recommend it for the reason that for reasons that you are being sold as valid reasons, right? And we are also nearing the end of the presentation, like 5 minutes left. One thing that I want to recommend, I would like to recommend as how to stay up with your career and how to progress. I think staying curious is a key. Honestly speaking, because if you get used to your technology and if you get married to the technology, the company, whatnot, and if you're trying to move afterwards, and I mean, technology will change and everything will change. And as you're still observing all the AI stuff coming up, whatever, things change. But if you're staying curious enough, I think and staying curious doesn't just mean being a person who likes to bullshit about interesting stuff. Staying curious actually means like doing the stuff, you know, like trying out new languages, new projects, building, trying out new and popular stuff, so that in case that you have to change your career, at least you know what's happening around, right? To give you one example, for example, I spent like I don't know 12, 13, 14 years working in Linux. I haven't used Windows in like maybe even 15 years, basically joining Microsoft just changed all of that, and I was on the verge of burning out because, you know, like what the hell is this? Like, it's a completely new world. But I tried applying this same principle. It's easier said than done, to be honest, but I tried applying the same principle, building the like stuff in .NET, in Windows, like specifically for Windows, and so far, basically, like sometimes later, it worked out great. So I think one of the best ways to stay ahead of your career or stay up to date is to remain curious and work actively on it, right? And another thing is, and this is really important, if you want to stand out from the crowd, you should definitely develop some unique skills, right? And if you ever listen to Naval Ravikant, basically the guy behind Angel Leads and whatnot, he had a perfect example of, if you see a bear, it's like interesting, right? If you see a bear who's dancing, that's like, you know, that gets your curiosity, right? Like it gets it working, like you stop and observe, like, well, that's a unique. If you see a bear that's dancing and singing, well, that's a completely, like that's a unicorn, right? So if you want to be, like, you should stay curious and definitely develop some additional skills. Again, easier said than done, but what I mean by additional skills, like writing, speaking sucks, like it's scary, but it's rewarding once you finish it. Writing, speaking, maybe even trying the sales, marketing, whatever. Just develop one additional skill aside from being an engineer, assuming that you are an engineer, and you will definitely stay ahead of your career and will profit. Right? And speaking of book recommendations that I said, yeah, we have some more time. The first book that I definitely recommend is Extreme Ownership. If you heard about it, great. If not, definitely read it. It's not about engineering or anything, but it's about taking ownership of the stuff, like owning your shit in the terms of Joe and his co-author. So basically, it talks about like how you take ownership, how you manage expectations. It talks about a lot of things from a unique perspective, but which is definitely applicable to career. And to tell you the truth, this is one of the books that actually made me think about switching to management track at one point. Right. So definitely a great book. Another book that I told you about is Becoming an Effective Engineering Manager. As I told you, there really is a lack of good books on what engineering management is, because it's definitely different than manufacturing. And if your manager has no idea what they're doing, they're probably applying the manufacturing skills to engineering, right? One of the best books that explores what it means, what are the tools, what are one-on-ones, what are like how you do tough talks, how you manage expectations, how you do project management and stuff like that. Definitely a worthy book, even if you're not considering management, it will definitely help you work with your manager better. So I definitely recommend it, and my manager loves it, basically, because, you know, like I'm applying some principles as an IC with my EM, and that's working out perfectly, I would say. And finally, The Manager's Path. It's not as great as two previous ones, but what I really liked about this book is that it pretty much outlines like all the roles from junior engineer to, I don't know, like group engineering manager, where you manage managers, right? And for each role, it discusses like what are the expectations, what are some pros and cons, what you should do, what you shouldn't do, and stuff like that. So it's kind of like a booklet of everything that's expected from each role, and it gives you a clue of what there is and what exists, right? So definitely an interesting read to, I don't know, skim through, right? And that's about it. I don't know if we have time for Q&A. I hope we do. If not, you can write on the app. I'll answer every question, maybe not immediately, but I'll try to answer by the end of the day to all of your questions. So with that, I'd like to thank you very much for attending. You can find me on LinkedIn, or you can see some of my, where I apply some writing skills. So I was basically, I'm standing behind my word, and I'm trying to develop additional skills, like aside from being just an engineer. That's about it. Thank you very much. Do we have time for Q&A or? Sorry?
We have
3 minutes. 3 minutes. Perfect. Come on. No, seriously, like, I really love questions. There. Sorry, okay. Oh, okay. Sorry? What did they work on? Oh man, I worked on cheat detection at the time. It was some crazy thing like written in Perl, and they wanted it rewritten to PHP. I have no idea. And the reason why they chose me is because I was probably the only person in probably the whole world at the time who actually used something called Stockfish Game Engine, which is something that they were trying to migrate to. I used it for my college as an example of how you can build a chess engine. So that was like one in a million possibility. Like, unless you're working there, I definitely recommend it. One of the best companies and one of the best CEOs. He's just an insane guy. So, was that the question or? Okay. Do you have a follow-up? All right. I think probably the whole reason is that their whole code base at the time, and still I think, was in PHP. So I guess that was the only reason. It was in Perl, but funny enough, the guy who was working on it just disappeared. It's not like he quit. He literally disappeared and they never saw him. I mean, he probably died or something, honestly speaking. Like, nobody knows what really happened to him. And they just wanted to rewrite it to something that, you know, is not as archaic as Perl, right? Yeah. Come on. Oh, okay, there. Ooh, it's a, I have no idea, because, you know, one of the huge issues that I personally have, and then I learned that so many other people have, like, I mean, I still am suffering from imposter syndrome my whole life, and like, lack of self-confidence, like, you name it, I have it, all right? Like, spent 7 years in therapy trying to work on my problems. So I suffered from imposter syndrome, still suffer, obviously. Jesus fucking Christ, like joining Microsoft, it puts you at such an edge of like because you're surrounded with incredibly great people, you know, and you just think that you suck. But then I later learned that everybody feels that way, especially if they come to senior, because I came as a senior. Like, I didn't even know how to log in into Windows, like, because I just didn't use Windows, you know? Like, last time I used C# or C++ was, I don't know, in college and stuff like that. So it was crazy, and for the first 6 months, and this seems to be a pattern, I expected that they would just fire me, you know? They still haven't, and they seem to be satisfied, but I wouldn't say I still stand a doubt, but ask me in a couple of years. So I'll be happy to answer that. Anyone else? Don't be scared. We are all scared. Okay. Sorry, I have like a light. Or you can just shout, it's fine.
Hi, can you hear me?
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, sure.
Yes, the voice from the light.
You're at a really bad position, my man.
Any personal project that would you recommend for a junior engineer?
What do you mean? Like any like what
personal projects, ideas, anything of the sort?
Yeah, to be honest, I have no idea. Like if I were a junior and if I were to build something, I would probably find a company or companies that I want to move to or positions that I want to move to. Right? I would see what their requirements are, because like I don't know, if you pick whatever company, the requirements rarely change, and I would just work on whatever they are working on. So that's what I would do. But something generic, I really think you should build whatever the company that you want to join in or companies that you want to join in are working with. Does that make sense?
Yep, logically. Awesome, thanks.
And there was someone else, I think, or no? There? Did they what, sorry? Did they try to apply what?
For a job.
Did they try to apply for a job? Did I try to apply, except for Microsoft?
Yeah.
I applied for, like, I don't know, like I applied for, I don't know, 30 companies or something, because like I was really trying both to practice my skills and basically see how I fit, and basically, yeah, I got a lot of rejections, to tell you the truth, yeah. So yeah, I definitely did, and that's why I'm telling you from experience. And it took me 3 attempts to go into Microsoft, actually, so yeah. What was my motivation to move to Big? To tell you the truth, I just figured out that, like, what are my other options? Like, I could either go, like, I was being forced towards becoming, like, I don't know, head of engineering at my at the time company and whatnot. And that was one option. I figured out that trying to move to another company was challenging, so to speak, because, yeah, I was solution architect, engineer, manager. I wasn't even sure what I wanted. Big tech just sounded like, and to tell you the truth, one of my biggest dreams that I brought about it was developing databases. Like I always had like an obsession on databases dating from, I don't know, like early 2000s. And I think there are some other folks, but SQL Server is like, you know, like one of the older databases. So basically it was a combination of those. And yeah, I definitely don't regret it, to be honest.
I'm an absolute to stop you right there.
Feel free to write on whatever.
Yeah, bother him after the talk. He'll be around.
Yeah, or that. Yeah, definitely. Thank you very much.
Everyone.
Thank you very much.